গুড মর্নিং টু অল অফ ইউ। মাইসেলফ ইমরানও থাকি আইজিএস গুন্টুর চ্যাপ্টার। দিস ইজ 33rd ওয়েবিনার অফ আইজিএস গুন্টুর চ্যাপ্টার অর্গানাইজড বাই আইজিএস স্টুডেন্ট চ্যাপ্টার পুট্টি শ্রীরামুলু చదలవాడి మల్లికార్జునరావు కాలేజ్ ఆఫ్ ఇంజనీరింగ్ అండ్ టెక్నాలజీ విజయవాడ. ఐజిఎస్ గుంటూరు చాప్టర్ ఎస్టాబ్లిష్ ఇన్ 2003 ఆర్గనైజ్డ్ నెంబర్ ఆఫ్ సెమినార్స్ వర్క్ షాప్స్ సిగ్నిఫికెంట్ బీయింగ్ ఐజిసి 2009 నేషనల్ కాన్ఫరెన్స్. ఐఎమ్ థ్యాంక్ఫుల్ టు Dr. R. Chitra, Joint Director, CSMRS in New Delhi, for delivering this lecture, Embankment Dams, Distress and Manifestation. Before introducing the speaker, a few announcements to participants. I request all the participants to stop your video. And during the lecture, you are going to chat with the host only, that is myself. Kindly send the information related to audio and video issues only. Please do not share your information and questions during the lecture. After completion of the lecture, I will share Google Form link, and its purpose is sharing the content of this lecture in PDF and your feedback. Question answer session through chat at the end of the lecture. Our next webinar at 6 p.m. on 27th, that is Saturday, at 6 p.m. by Professor N.K. Samadhiya, Department of Civil Engineering, IIT Roorkee. And the title of webinar lecture is Influence of Seepage Force on Active and Passive Thrust for the Design of a Rigid Cutoff Wall. Now I request Ms. G. Susmita, Assistant Professor and Advisor to IGS Student Chapter, to introduce this speaker. Susmita, please unmute yourself and introduce the speaker. Susmita, unmute yourself. Susmita, unmute yourself. So please wait 1 minute. Susmita. Hello. Susmita, Susmita, please introduce the speaker. Susmita, if there any problem, it is not audible, your voice. Are you able to hear our voice? Please send through chat.
Good morning to everyone.
Now it is audible. You can go ahead. Hello, Susmita. Voice. Are you able to hear our voice? Yes, yes, yes. Susmita.
Good morning, everyone.
You can raise the voice.
Good morning to everyone. I am Susmita, Assistant Professor from Potti Sriramulu Chalavadi Mallikarjuna College of Engineering and Technology. It's glad to inform that the IGS student chapter was recently started in our college. As a part of it, it is the second technical webinar organized by the student chapter under IGS Guntur chapter. Now it's a privilege to introduce today's speaker, Dr. R. Chitra, she is graduated from Government College of Engineering, Tirunelveli, Tamil Nadu, and she did her post-graduation and PhD from Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi. Presently, she is working as Joint Director at Central Soil and Materials Research Station, Department of Water Resources, River Development and Ganga Rejuvenation, Ministry of Jal Shakti. She has 33 years of experience in the field of geotechnical engineering pertaining to water resources projects. Her experience in planning, guiding, and execution of geotechnical investigation works for river valley projects has spread to over 335 projects within India and neighboring countries such as Nepal, Bhutan, Afghanistan, and Myanmar. Her interests include hydropower development, earth and rockfill dams, problematic soils, risk assessment of dams, numerical modeling, ash containment systems, geosynthetics in water resources, artificial neural networks, and quality control of hydroelectric projects. She has published over 235 technical papers in various international and national journals and conference proceedings. She is an expert committee member of major dam safety review panels and technical advisory committees of various dam and irrigation projects. She is also a member of various committees of national repute like BIS, IRC, etc. And her contribution towards formulation, review, and updation of various Indian standard codes are substantial. She is a recipient of many awards from the geotechnical fraternity for her extraordinary contributions to the geotechnical engineering field. We all welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you so
now,
much.
Now, I would like to hand out this session to Chitra, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, Professor Smita.
Various Indian standard codes are substantial. She is a recipient of many awards from the geotechnical fraternity for her expertise
in the geotechnical engineering field.
We all welcome
you, ma'am. Thank you. I would like to hand over the session to Chitra, ma'am. Yeah, thank you, Professor Smita.
Smita.
She is a recipient of many awards from the geotechnical fraternity.
Sushmita, stop your audio. Madam, now you can start.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Good morning to all of you for joining this interesting session on embankment dams and distress and manifestation. As briefed you about me, where I'm working, I just want to brief a little bit about my organization where I am presently working. It's a Central Soil and Materials Station working under Department of Water Resources, Ganga Rejuvenation and River Development under the umbrella of Ministry of Jal Shakti. And this organization has started since 1954. And working specially for the water resources sector, especially the hydroelectric project, which is not barring from working with the other projects. I think I am audible to everyone, right, Mr. Rao?
Yes, madam.
Okay.
Audible.
Yeah, we have worked specialized work for other sectors like the railways, roads, thermal power stations, and other projects also. And mainly wherever the problems comes, like the legal battle is there between some clients, the court specifically orders the clients or directs the people to our institution. So we are proud to be associated with every work, and especially for the detailed project report, which is submitted for the sanction of the Government of India. We are one among the four institutions which involves the clearance of that. So, and we are stationed in New Delhi specifically, and we don't have any other branches in their country. But our engineers and I myself go to different projects spreaded all over the India and to the neighboring countries also, like Myanmar, Bhutan, Nepal, and so on. And even our people were stationed in Afghanistan for construction of the big dam and the friendship dam of Salma Dam project. And we were associated with many quality control or quality assurance of many projects. Our people were stationed in Bhutan also for many projects. Like since I am working for my entire career in soil mechanics, my specific field in embankment dam, which will give the distresses, what all the distresses which we can expect in that, we experience it. And what we have to do, we are just ending with that. And I'll take 1 hour exactly. I'll try to finish it as quickly as possible. And for since I have to finish it within within an hour, I may have to skip some of the presentation.
With Professor Rao, you may get it. And now starting with my.
Your audio is stopped.
Yeah, I don't know.
Now it is okay.
Why it is not moving further? Yeah.
Madam, spotlight you can use.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. First of all, I'll just begin with the introduction. And what all the distress and manifestation you expect in an embankment dam, and with the geotechnical investigations, what all the investigations you have to do, and I'll ending up with some case studies. Some case studies very briefly I'll be explaining, and one of the case studies I'll give it in full detail, which had the distress. So failure causes may be because of the foundation deterioration. Maybe the cause of that foundation deterioration may be removal of solid and soluble materials, rock plucking or undercutting. The foundation instability may be because of the liquefaction, slides or subsidence or fault movement. Defective spillways may be because of the obstructions, broken linings, evidence of overtaxing of available capacity or faulty gates and hoists. Defective outlets may be obstruction, silt accumulations, faulty gates and hoists, gate position and location. Concrete deterioration may be because of the alkali aggregate reaction, freezing thawing or leaching. Concrete dam defects may be because of the high uplift pressure, unanticipated uplift distribution, differential displacements and deflections, overstressing. Embankment dam defects, if you see here, the liquefaction potential, slope instability, excessive leakage, removal of solid and soluble materials, slope erosion. Here specifically, embankment dam may be constructed for the roadways and the railways also. We are particularly talking about the water retaining structure, the embankment dams constructed for retaining the water. We are discussing about that only in further in this lecture. The reservoir margin defects may be perviousness of the reservoir rim, instability, inherent weakness of the natural barriers. What are the different types of embankment dams? It may be earth dam or earth fill dam, which is more than 50% of the total volume is formed of compacted inorganic soil obtained from a borrow area. Homogeneous earth fill dam, an embankment dam constructed of similar earth material throughout except for the inclusion of internal drains or drainage blankets, distinguished from a zone earth fill dam. So if you don't provide any drainages in between, like in a vertical filter or incline filter, it tends to, since we are using the embankment for retaining the water, the earth material may saturate fully at the full reservoir conditions. So we have to keep slow down or lower down the periodic surfaces at the full reservoir condition. In order to keep the periodic surface low, we have to provide these drainages also. That can be of many types that we'll see. It may be a zone dam, which is composed of the zones of selected materials having different degrees of porosity, permeability, and density. We are not blessed with the full, because the embankment dams are the natural structure which is built with the natural material. We cannot say we'll construct with only clay or sand or clayey sand or this kind of material which is having clays of this or silts of this or gravels of this. We can't, we are not that fortunate to have the specific gradation of the material. So we have to be satisfied with what is available. According to the availability of the material, we have to design that structure. The rock fill dam and embankment dam, which is more than 50% of the total volume, is composed of compacted or dumped material, natural or crushed rock. So the earth dam, when it formed, what is the first of man's engineering structure is the earth dam only. The earliest known instinct earth dam were between 500 BC to 200 BC. One of the first earth dam was 17.7 kilometer long, 21.3 meter high, contained about 13 million meter cube of earth. Earliest Indian dams were from 500 AD, particularly in the period after 1000 AD. Largest earth dam was constructed 450 years ago. So if you see what is the condition in the Indian scenario, the largest earth dam of an olden era was 45.7 meter high, constructed in Spain. Next largest dam was 38.1 high, Baden Dam in England, constructed during 1876. The dams can be constructed for many purposes, maybe a single purpose or a multi-purpose. Single purpose means it is constructed for only for irrigation, or multiple means it may be for irrigation, it may be for hydropower, it may be for water supply, it may be for flood control, recreation, navigation, fish breedings, and other utilities also. This is the scenario, but what is the scenario in India? So out of the, this is specially taken from the National Register for Large Dams issued by CW, Central Water Commission, in the year 2019. So if you see, out of the whole dams, 65% of the dam are earth dams and 13% are rock fill dams. Rest is others. And these are all the highest dam. I just wanted to show you the highest dams which are registered for its height. The highest dam is 335, which is a earthen rock fill dam. And the highest earthen rock fill dam in India is the Terry Dam, which is of 260.5 meters. The next highest dam is the Kol Dam of 163 to 168 meter high in Himachal Pradesh, in the across the river Satluj. And if you see the total dam which is constructed already, the completed dam is 534 out of the earth dam. The last dam we are talking about, more than 15 meter is the, from the deepest foundation to the crest. The most of the dams constructed are in the state of Maharashtra. If you aware of the soil map of India, Maharashtra is very rich in possessing the swelling soil or expansive soil, but locally it is called as the black cotton soil. Like even Gujarat also, most of its land is locked up with the expansive soil only. The next state is the Madhya Pradesh. Even the under construction project, if you see, the majority of the dam is being constructed in Maharashtra. That's what I wanted to show. Now, if you see the history of the dam, earthen dam construction, the most of the dams were constructed during the year 1971 to 1990. That is the year where most of the dams failed also. Even this is the world scenario as well as in India as well. The fourth oldest dam in the world is constructed by King Karihala Chola of Chola dynasty in the 2nd century AD, located in the across the river Kaveri, which is a very small one. Even today, it is functioning very well and maintained very good. But improvements were made by Sir Arthur Cotton, who is father of irrigation projects in India. He is being named as, and he has made this improvement during 19th century. So this is very closer by within 5 kilometers from the city called Trichy. You can visit this structure there, well maintained one. But that is a small dam, and we are not very new to the construction of the big dam. Rockfield Dam, we can say. This is the dam which is the 9th oldest earth dam in the world, constructed by Sri Asuri near the city Bangalore. This lake, for closing the lake of this 230 meter high and 140 meter long Rockfield Dam was constructed, and it is still maintained very nicely near the city Bangalore, and in this lake is providing water supply to the city Bangalore. And different types of embankment dam, it may be on a homogeneous embankment dam on impervious foundation or pervious foundation. And why we have to go for embankment dam, that itself is a very long process. Why the many dams are there, gravity dam, masonry dam, or earthen dam, or rock fill dam, or any dam. How you select that one, that depends on different category like topography, selection of material, climate, and everything. So what I said is, the drains are provided in the homogeneous dam to keep the phreatic surface low in order to avoid the saturation of the downstream slope of the structure. And here, this is the centrally placed clay core with the embankment material or the rock fill material. It is placed on central core embankment on impervious foundation. It can be constructed on the pervious foundation also, but you have to provide exact contact with the rock foundation also. So the homogeneous embankment dam consists of entirely one material only. The good material for construction of the homogeneous material is the clayey gravels, and except the for slope protection or wave protection, whatever provided riprap is being provided. The section is made of low permeability material and requires flatter slopes than a zoned section, usually constructed from clay, sandy clay, clayey sand, and gravel sand clayey soils. May also be constructed from more permeable soils such as silty sand, sand, and sandy gravels, provided seepage is within the acceptable limit, but it is not suitable for a large heights. Modified homogeneous dam has toe drain, horizontal drain, and the vertical drain as well. The zoned embankment dam consists of different zones of different types of soils. There is an impervious zone called the core inside, which possesses totally impervious drainage characteristics. And the outer zones on both the sides are called as the shell or casing material, which may be of semi-pervious or pervious material. So these different zones are separated by filters so that the migration of the finer particles is arrested. The rockfill dams are best suitable for the seismic zone because the gravels are good absorbent material of the seismic forces. It consists of various sizes of rock to provide stability to an impervious core or membrane, which is constructed very vertically or with the steep slopes, and which provides totally water tightness. Adapted to locations where good rock is available, foundation rock is or near the ground surfaces, long periods of high rainfall may make construction of an earth dam impracticable. Rock fill dams may be different kinds are there. Central earth clay core with the central earth clay core, upstream sloping earth core, concrete faced and rock filled dam. The selection of the type of the embankment dam based on the topography, based on the overall economics of a project with consideration of the dam, spillway, river diversion, outlet works, etc. Project components are interrelated as diversion tunnel is longer for earth dam than rock fill dam. Spillway excavation generates rock fill, earth fill and random fill for use in the embankment. Large floods can be allowed to overtop the dam so as to avoid larger diversion of the tunnels and the high cofferdams. And an embankment dam fails when you allow the overtopping of, over the dam also. So I'll show you the percentage of failure because of this overtopping as well. So narrow steep-sided valleys favors this concrete-faced rock fill dam. Use of extensive filters where differential settlement in abutments are anticipated may be avoided by adopting CFRD. Geology and the foundation conditions. Soil foundation favors the earth dam. Strong, low permeability rock foundation is suited to any type of dam. Limestone foundation requires extensive grouting to limit seepage. Therefore, to carry out grouting along the dam construction, earth come rock fill dam with upstream inclined core may be adopted. Sedimentary rocks, particularly interbedded weak claystone and mudstone, favors the earth dam. Areas with the deep weathered rock favor the earth dam. With the available construction material, the material should be available in sufficient quantity with a reasonable haul distance from the site. Materials available or near the site may be soils for embankment, rock for the embankment and riprap, sand, gravel, and crushed stone, etc. for providing the drainages like filters. Availability of the suitable rocks favors the rock fill dams. If suitable soils are found in nearby borrow area, an earth dam is more economical. If earth fill material is not available, then concrete faced rock fill dam is an option. If the borrow area has two soils, earth fill may be zoned. Blending of soils is generally avoided as it leads to increased cost. Seismicity, like I said before, in the seismic zones, rock fill dam is suitable more than an earth dam. Climate. Earth dam construction is very difficult in wet weather. It is advantageous to adopt CFRD or ECRD with the sloping upstream core to continue placement of the rock fill in wet weather and constructing the face slab or core in the fair weather. Very arid areas having shortage of water for construction. So the it favors CFRD as compared to the earth dam. So coming to the distresses, what all the distresses manifest can be. The failure of the earthen dams, it may be because of the hydraulic failure, seepage failure, or the structural failure. Hydraulic failure means because of the overtopping of dams, erosion of the upstream surface, erosion of the downstream surface, and erosion of the downstream toe. Seepage failure may be because of the piping through the dam. Why it happens? Piping through the foundation, conduit leakage. Structural failure may be failure of downstream face during the steady seepage condition. Failure of upstream face during sudden drawdown. Failure due to sliding of foundation. Damage due to burrowing animals. Failure of dam due to earthquake. During construction, pore water pressure built up during the construction and reduction of shear strength due to thixotropical property. So the embankment dam fails after the construction because of the hydraulic fracturing or internal erosion or piping. Excess hydrostatic pressure due to rapid drawdown also makes the embankment fails after construction. Reduction in shear strength, weathering, and swelling of compacted soil. settlement and cracking, and earthquake forces. Factors influencing the cracking failure, if the construction of if the embankment is constructed with a low construction moisture content. Silts and silty clays with the D50 and blasticity index less than 50. Here again, we are trying to construct the smallest of the embankment also for the diversion for constructions to be commencing. We are trying to construct the diversion embankments or any small dikes, even with the plasticity, with the soil which is having as low as 7 also. So 7 means that is why we always restrict it. We strictly say the plasticity index should be less than 15, but we are allowing the plasticity index from 12 to 15 also, because for searching for the soil possessing plasticity index more than 15 is very difficult in some of the regions. So we allow that, but we in no case we can allow even for a very small structure or temporary structure, we cannot allow the soil to be used for the construction of the embankment dam if it is less than 10 or 12. So steep rock abutment, and there is no contact, proper contact is there between the abutment and the structure. Abrupt change in the dam height. Even well-graded soils, if compacted with the less moisture content and exposed to further weathering, also undergo cracking. In one of the case history which I'll be presenting, I'll tell you what was the problem there. Even for compaction also, if you understand the moisture and the dry density relationship, you will able to correlate what we are talking about. So if we are not maintaining a proper compaction and are compacted with the less moisture, that will tend to lead to a cracking. Crack formation due to arching effect, stiff and brittle material, silty clays with low plasticity may lead to cracking failure. And igneous residual soft soil rapidly disintegrating coarse particles, subsequent saturation causes important settlements. And factors influencing the piping failure may be because of progressive backward erosion, progressive backward sloughing or reveling of the saturation downstream slope. Seepage takes place in the form of well-defined water veins, drying cracks, inadequately compacted material between compact embankment and foundation, relatively pervious horizontal compaction layer. Slope slides may be because of the dimension of the dam, nature of the embankment material, or with the development of the pore water pressure. So the major components of the embankment dams is shown in this figure. This is the embankment dam. This portion is called as the crest. This is the reservoir, and this is the upstream slope. This is the downstream slope, and the toe drain is provided on the downstream end, and it which is having a plunge pool here and which is having a conduit also. So basically, if you use a pipe system for the conduit within this embankment, the failure may take place if proper contact is not there between this conduit and the embankment, then it may fail at this place. And even clogging of this toe drain may cause the development of the pore water pressure within the structure and then cause failure. And if the contact between this abutment and the structure is not proper, then also the structure may fail. And when you place this structure on the foundation preparation is also very much required. So from here onwards, we'll go for common problems, which is found on the dams. So it may be because of the trees and bush, And I have seen many of the structures which I'm visiting. One of it, I can never forget, the forest department has planted many trees on the downstream slope of this. When I visited the structure, I had to tell them to remove all those things. And one of the case study, I'll show you the big trees, which has caused the distress in that embankment. The animals can cause distress to the structure, and burrowing rats, rodents activities may cause the distress, and settlement in the crest of the dam, and wave erosion can cause distress on the upstream slope of it. Already I have told you that the leakage out of the conduit may induce the internal erosion. Internal erosion, because of the material property, also can cause distress. And the cracking of any kind, there may be desiccation crack or transverse crack or longitudinal crack, any kind of cracks may cause distress to the structure. So you have the boil from the downstream end of it, downstream side of the structure, it will cause the problem to the structure. So the trees on the embankment should not be planted or allowed to grow on the dams. Tree root systems create pathways or water and can damage the dam if they are uprooted. Seepage through the dam damaged by the tree roots should not be allowed to grow on the dam. The recommended action may be, do not allow it. Remove the largest trees and their roots and backfill the holes with well-compacted soil. Don't dump any soil on it. Before removing the roots, the reservoir should be lowered to reduce the risk of serious seepage problem developing during the removal. If possible, remove trees at the toe of the dam to provide a 4 to 5 meter buffer around the dam. Next is, maybe probable causes, cause and probable consequences may be areas of trees and bushes, and open water provide ideal habitat for burrowing animals. And it may, the rodent activities, of course, it will have a hole. Sometimes you can see the upstream side from the downstream. So it is through because of the rodent one. What you have to do? You have to start repairing those. Here, this is shown from the downstream side, the upstream reservoir, the water can be seen here. And it may be because of the inadequate vegetation and erosion. And maybe the land subsidence have taken place on the riprap provided, or the failure of the filter materials provided in that. Better, you have to repair this materials by lowering the water level in the reservoir. It may be overgrazing, poor weed control, concentrated runoff, and wave erosion are common causes for poor vegetative cover and erosion on the dam. So what you have to do, areas of sparse vegetation should be reseeded with perennial grasses each spring or fall. So you have to control the weeds. And it may be because of the obstruction in the principal or auxiliary spillways. So this is a clogged one. So you have to, the inlet completely plugged with the debris. So you just remove those debris and try to around the spillway and try to make it workable. Here again, you can see inadequate trenches of rocks. You can see here. And cracks and slides, maybe only a centimeter or two wide, but 0.5 to 1 meter deep. Usually, a depth of more than 0.5 meter means that a serious condition is present. Shallow cracks may be harmless, desiccation cracks only. But all cracks over 0.3 meter deep should be closely checked and evaluated. Cracks may be also be a sign of foundation movement or failure, the beginning of the embankment failure or a surface slide. For example, 6-meter long line of recently dislodged riprap along the upstream slope could indicate a crack underneath the riprap. Longitudinal crackings may be the sign of localized instability, differential settlement, foundation settlement, and movement between the adjacent sections of the embankment. Vertical, longitudinal, it may be vertical displacements on the crest or usually accompanied by displacements or bulging on the upstream or downstream faces of the dam. Longitudinal cracks can allow storm water and reservoir water to enter the embankment. When water enters the embankment, the strength of the embankment material next to the crack may be reduced. The lower strength of the embankment material can lead to accelerate the slides and slope stability failure. Transverse cracking may be a sign of differential settlement or movement between the adjacent segments within the embankment or the underlying foundation. Transverse crack is poses a definite threat to the safety and integrity of the dam. So you have to avoid it. How to avoid all these problems? You have to construct the embankment while constructing itself with the proper quality control and quality assurances with proper design, actually. So the probable uneven movement settlements of the cracks in the crest is uneven movement between the adjacent sections of the dam embankment may cause settlements and transverse cracking. Cracks and settlements can create a point for water to flow through or over the dam. When reservoir levels reach the crack or settlement, it can lead to erosion and rapid failure of the dam. Embankment slopes that are too steep or saturated soils can cause longitudinal cracking and slides to develop, causing serious damages to large sections of the dam. So what you have to do? Shallow settlements should be filled with topsoil and reseeded. Shallow cracks should be filled with mud pack. Mud pack is made of by adding 90% of the earth with 10% of the cement mixture until a slurry of thin cement consistency is attained. Deep or recurring settlements and cracks or large slides should be evaluated by a qualified engineer to determine the cause and supervise all steps necessary to reduce the danger to the dam and correct the condition. So some dams have drains or relief wells to control seepage. Over the time, the drain can become plugged, submerged or buried and lose their effectiveness in controlling the seepage through the dam. So cloudy or mudding flow from the drain could be a sign that water is causing erosion inside the dam. And what you have to do? Mark the location of the drain outlets and T-posts so that they are easily located during the inspections. Notify and lower the reservoir level and do this. Internal erosion of the earth dams or because of the internal erosion of the soil particles formed within the dam by water that seeps through the dam is one of the most causes of the failure of the earth dams. Internal erosion is especially dangerous because there may be no external evidence or only subtle evidence that is taking place. A dam may breach within few hours after evidence of the internal erosion becomes obvious, like what had happened in the Teton Dam. It's a very interesting case, classic case of just after the construction of the dam. Internal erosion may develop the first time water is impounded behind a dam, or it may develop over many years. You cannot assume that your dam is safe against the internal erosion just because it has performed satisfactorily for many years. Internal erosion failures are more often associated with the penetration of dams such as outlet pipes. buried in the embankment and concrete spillways that cross the embankment. Yeah, this is the muddy water which comes out of the corrugated metal outlet pipes. It's an indication of the failure, internal erosion. And what we are looking for, the muddy waters and all. And I'll just skip what we have to do. Generic cause during the project planning, lack of clear scope, conflicting the client expectation, design errors, maybe because of the conceptual design errors, lack of redundancy, failure to identify all loads and load combinations, calculation errors, maybe specification deficiencies, and failure considering the surveillance, monitor, and maintenance. Most of the cases are coming because of the surveillance, monitoring, and maintenance problems only. Construction errors, of course, inappropriate temporary works, improper sequencing, improper method of timing of construction, excessive construction loads. Material deficiency, of course, this also leads to the structural failure of the dam. Material inconsistency, premature deterioration, and fabrication defects. And safety inspection of the dams, routine periodic inspection is very important by trained and experienced engineers from the dam safety organization, at least twice a year, pre-monsoon and post-monsoon period. Examination of general health of the dam and appurtenant structure is required periodically, and preparedness of the dam and hydromechanical structures for handling expected floods. Comprehensive dam safety evaluation is also required once in a 10-year, and more comprehensive examination is required. Multidisciplinary team for holistic view on the operation of the dam and the behavior of the dam is required. May order additional field and laboratory investigations as well as numerical simulations. So coming to the investigation, typical dam safety investigations may include sampling and testing methods to define. I'm not going to talk about detailly about what is that geotechnical investigation, how it is to be done, what are the different things. I will talk about the parameters which are required for assessing the safety of the dam only. The potential or liquefaction, seepage and piping, static stability, collapse of foundation soils, cracking, and emergency repair and dam remediation activities typically require some drilling components to collect data. So this I'll just... specifically, we just go for, we have many, in the already constructed dams, when we go for inspection, we should not take a decision that we will go for a drilling of holes and do the SPT or CPT. The selection of this particular site or location on the already constructed dam is very, very important. You should not puncture the periodic surface in the dam. That is the main reason you have to select a particular location and particular place to study the safety evaluation of the existing embankment. And we have many compaction controls. We have many methods to determine the in-situ density of the embankment. But which one to use? The limitation of each of the method also you should understand. And for determining the moisture content of the existing dam also is very, very important. So you may not be able to do the core cutter method or sand replacement method or the water and the ring replacement method. Sometimes you may have to adopt specific methodology for taking the big particle. This is the photograph, the in-situ density being measured for the clay core material of the Terry dam. Specifically, if we talk about Terry Dam, it's very interesting to talk about it because the clay core, it is called as a clay core, but it is the height of the dam is too large, means 260.5 meter. And in the upper portion of the dam, even the 80 mm size of the gravels were mixed. And the taking those kinds of material in the core cutter, it's not possible. So we have to take a clod and then take the weight of it and the volume of it and determine the in-situ density of it, of that particular material. So this is what, how it was done, that this photographs narrates that one. And this is the water replacement method, how you have to do it. This is the shell material or the rock fill material for which it is being done. And embankment material, it should be an impervious core material, recommend with the recommended grain size distribution. No oversized materials are allowed. It should be totally impermeable. It should meet the requirements of physical and mechanical properties. Filters material, filter materials should be free draining material conforming to the specified grain size distribution, free from organic or undesirable materials and size, and it should meet the requirement physical and mechanical properties. And it should be compatible with the base material as well. The filter material suitability analysis using the D50, D10, D85 and D50 also should be checked according to the appropriate IS codes. The rock fill material should be hard, durable, sound against weathering, resistant to excessive breakage during the handling and compaction operations, should be a free draining, conforming to the specified gradation, borrowed from specified quarry or riverbed material. The behavior of the characteristics of the quarried material is different from the characteristics of the riverbed material. So it should ultimately meet the physical and mechanical properties of the specified standards. So clay core material or the embankment material, the material or soil used for the construction of the embankment dam also should be a well-graded material, because well-graded material will have a impervious, the permeability characteristics will be very fine. If it is a poorly graded or a gap graded one, it should not be used for the construction of the dam. So it should be a totally impervious because it is used for retaining the water. So it should be low permeable, non-dispersive. So nowadays it has become very mandatory for identifying the soil dispersivity characteristics of that soil to be used for embankment dam or earth clay core material in an earth and rock fill dam. So presently the IS codes are not available for characterizing for the soil dispersivity identification, but we are, CSMRS is involved in formulating these codes. Four tests are done. One is a double hydrometer test with the dispersing agent and without the dispersing agent. Another is crumb test. Third is pinhole test and the pore water extract analysis. It's a qualitative test only, I'll say. The pinhole test and the pore water extract test, we can somewhat say it is a quantitative test. But the consensus arrived based on these four tests arrives at the category, whether it is a dispersive soil in a non-dispersive soil or an intermediate soil. Pore water extract means soil is saturated soil is taken and the water is extracted from that saturated soil, and these different salts are measured, so like sodium, calcium, magnesium, and the percentage of the sodium soil among these four salts are relatively compared, and the more the sodium, the more the dispersive characteristics you will be classified with. So the low erodible soils, of course, we cannot afford to have. It should be a flexible soil, low compressible, and it should possess a good shear strength characteristics. So for this embankment material, we should do grain size distribution, Atterberg's limits, shrinkage limit, specific gravity, Proctor compaction, shear strength, one-dimensional consolidation, permeability and soil dispersivity and chemical analysis also. I missed that one. So this table I have taken from the code IS 12169, 1987. The recent also has come. And which one is good for the homogeneous dam and which one is good for the zone dam. Like I said, the clay gravels are the suitable material for this. And the organic soils cannot be allowed to be used for the construction of the dam. But we have an experience of allowing an organic soil after the improvement of it, stabilization of that soil, because the project is located in Sikkim, where no other material was available. So we wanted the blended material should be used for that. And in some of the area in Jharkhand also, good materials were not available. But there some two borrow areas were there. One was not suitable and one borrow area material was not suitable because it was pervious in nature or semi-pervious in nature. And one was highly compressible material. So by blending these two types of soil, we can get a good material. So why not? We can go for that. But somebody may ask me, blending, or is it possible to blend two materials or the stabilizing agents and get a good material? Yes, with the good latest technology available with us, we can use it. We are not blessed with a good material naturally available. So we have to go with this. So if the proper compaction is there, then we will be able to construct the dam with full quality control and quality assurance have to be achieved. What are the materials to be avoided if you have to avoid the distress in the embankment dam? The organic material should be avoided. Decomposing material. Material with high proportion of mica. Mica is having the erosion kind of, it's not having cohesion at all, which forms slip surfaces in the soil of low clay percentages. Calcitic soils such as clays derived from limestone, which although generally stable are usually very permeable. Fine silts, which are unsuitable for any zones of the dam because it can cause erosion. Piping. Cist and shales, which although often gravelly in texture, tend to disintegrate when wet. Cist may also contain a high portion of the mica. Sodic soils, of course, cannot be available. Sodic soils are the main culprit of the dispersive soils. And these are the different codes which is used for the in relation to the embankment dams. And for subsurface exploration, these are the codes. And there are codes for providing the distresses, failures and solution to earth and rock fill dam. There is a code available. You can refer to that code as well. And coming to the categories of the dam failures, overtopping, quality problems, poor management, disasters and others. I'm not going into the details. If you see here, overtopping 36.4%, quality problems 42.5%, and everything else is less. So the quality problem tops everything. We have to construct the structure very carefully with the proper density and proper with the proper moisture control. And among the quality problems also, piping in the dam body and foundation tops it all, 58%. The sliding of the dam body, 18.3%. Piping around spillway is very meager one. So coming, these are all the dams, embankment dams, which is failed. And I like to show the failure of the dams in India. And the latest one, I'm going to show you is this one in detail, but in 10 minutes, okay? So the dam failures, 44% of it breaches failure due to flooding. So this I can skip. In Indian scenario, the dam failures are because of poor project planning, poor investigations, poor design, unsatisfactory location or site selection, faulty or poor construction practices, poor construction rescheduling, and poor coordination between design and construction unit. So the case study is first one. It's a project, irrigation project in Maharashtra. Maharashtra, already I told you, I have mentioned already the expansive presence of expansive soil. This is Vidarbha region, some of the big, mega project, which is having, this is the canal system. You can see the longitudinal crack and the transverse cracking in on the canal lining. You can see the different patches on the embankment. You can see means repair is being taken. And because of the presence of swelling soil here, the concrete lining fails, bulges and fails. In the cutting portion of this structure, it fails. And they are constructing, this is a retaining wall, a rigid structure of retaining wall is being constructed for stopping the slippage of this one. This happens, we expect in the cutting portion of it. If the filling section is constructed properly with the proper compaction and the moisture, especially when you deal with the expansive soil or blackcotton soil, then we have procedures of placing the CNS material in the canal sections, but which soil is to be classified as CNS material, and CNS means cohesive non-swelling soils, which one, where you will be limiting, that is the problem. And this is another project, Devanabelakere Dam in Karnataka, which is a runoff scheme only, not a big dam, very small earthen dam, but throughout the year, the water is being retained with this structure. But if you see here in the downstream, the swamps, the water is being accumulated here. The water going from the reservoir is being accumulated here and making a swamp. And it is a very threat or death trap for cattle, which is because it is greenery because of the presence of the water. So cattle are coming here and it is trapped. It is a death trap for those people, those things. If you see here, there is a movement of this downstream slope, and this is the toe drain you can see here. And the settlement pillars also, it is moved. From this view, you can see the subsidence of the downstream slope here. This is because of it, because of the toe drains are inoperational. In addition to this, what we are doing is it's clogged, and we are not thinking properly and planning properly, poor management. When we visited this one as a dam safety review panel, then we saw concrete slabs were casted and placed on the downstream, next to the structure on the downstream, just adjacent to the downstream. So we have to tell them what they have to do to rectify all those things. And for many years, we have to be after them for rectifying this one. This is a classic case, Subarnarekha. It's a very mega project, Subarnarekha irrigation project in Odisha. Five states are being benefited with this project, like Jharkhand, Chhattisgarh, Odisha, some part of Telangana, and West Bengal as well. So because of the 1 kilometer stretch of failure, this is because of the expansive soil. The slope fails. So we have to provide, we have identified it is not because of the dispersive soil, it is because of the expansive soil only. And we have to say, okay, if you go for this, many attempts of giving the solution and the remedies were failed. So ultimately what we had to do is we have to remove this entire stretch of expansive soil to make the entire mega project to happen and provide them the material which is to be placed in place of this expansive soil. What material? Where from we will get? the material available with them. When it is referred to CSMRS, we ask for what is the material available next to your project. Then Murram soils were available, and when we tested it, it was having a permeability of very low drainage characteristics. So, but for the construction of the embankments for the canal, the permissible permeability criteria should be 10 to the power of minus 5 centimeter per second. So in order to achieve that, what we have to do it, we have to blend it with the sand and then get the optimum amount of sand to be blend with that. And we have given that percentage of how much it is to be the Murram soil, red soil, or how much is to be the sand. Then at present, recently, this project has been commenced successfully by the Odisha Irrigation Project. And CSMRS is very proud to be associated with that project. Now, the one project I was telling you, the Kanhar Irrigation Project, which is a very old project, which was 1980s, it was started, and more than 30 years it has been both two parties are there, politically influenced and the design also. So some portion of it, it is constructed already, 30 years old constructions are there, you can see. And there are rain cuts on the downstream slope as well as the upstream slopes as well. And we have to see, and to some extent, to some height it has been constructed. And the height of the embankment dam is to be raised further. How to raise that one? Without proper preparation, it cannot be raised. So you have to check the toe drain which you are seeing here. These toe drains have been constructed during 1980s itself. And whether it is functioning or not, that is to be checked before doing it. And when you are urge of completing a structure finishing that construction of that structure, then you tend to engage many contractors and giving different portions, because the total length of this dam is 4.5 kilometers in the eastern part of Uttar Pradesh. And for reaching this project itself, it is very tedious. And I visited that project as well. And when I visited, then I saw there was no proper compaction was there. Compaction was achieved very high with very low moisture content. So I had to stop the projects for some time to tell them what is the moisture which plays its moisture criteria, which is very important for the construction of the dam. And this dam is resumed now. Another problem was there was a crack, big rock material within that embankment alignment was there, and they didn't want to blast this material. They wanted this rock also to be part of that embankment, but it can be a part of it. It is better you don't have it. But if you have a proper contact with this, but this is not coming in the tail end of the embankment. It is coming just next to the composite section of next to the spillway it was coming. So which is very dangerous. So we have to, CSMRS has to intervene, and it has to give its opinion how it is to be done. And we have listed out what they have to do it, and we have given it. And this is one more project. Last year, I think we have visited as a member of the dam safety experts. This is the Willingdon Dam in the state of Tamil Nadu, which is having slippage of slopes for many years. And what is the reason for slippage of the course? Every time sinking of the top bund, longitudinal cracks, you can see it here, and flow of mud at the downstream slope, upheaval of the downstream beyond the toe, and everything. And this is the dam section, you can see. This portion also is constructed using the highly compressible clay material, I can say. And that is why that is contained in the hardening zone, and in the casing zone, little bit of semi-pervious material were used for construction of this dam. And the horizontal blanket drains were provided with connecting with the toe drain, rock toe drain. And you can see here in the upstream slope, end of the upstream slope, longitudinal cracks were there. And the movement of this upstream slope, you can see here. And in order to bypass the problematic zones, especially these zones, a new embankment was constructed straight here, avoiding this embankment. And this new dam also was having the rain cuts, and there is a movement of this, and it is not properly covered. And see, you can see the cracks over here because of the poor compaction and those things. And the moisture was also, it was too dry. So you have to rehabilitate these things, and then you have to provide a solution to it and then rectify that. And that has been done. And now after 1.5 years, it has been rescued now. And there is one more tank. This is the Cholavaram tank, which is located very near to Chennai, which is one of the lake which provides a drinking water supply to the city Madras, Chennai, and which is having cracks in the downstream faces. And you can see the movement of the dam in the upstream faces. Okay, and loosely, and these cracks were tried to rectify by dumping the loose materials at the downstream face. And this again, the land subsidence in the downstream face as well. But generally, what I am experiencing it, if there is a movement of the slope, people are trying to place more material on that moving slope and providing more problem to that moving slopes, so which is to be avoided. So everywhere we say that only to everyone. This is an interesting case, Garada Earthen Dam project, which is located in Rajasthan. It's an embankment dam, medium irrigation project across the river Mangli. And it is in the confluence of three nalas, which is of 4.271 kilometers. And the maximum height of this dam is 30 meters. Dam failed on 15th August 2010. It's said to be a homogeneous embankment section constructed with the CL or CA type soil type. And this is what the section should have, having a core material. What I can understand is this is a hardening zone and a filter here and a casing material here with a riprap on the upstream slope. But when it had failed in the last dam closure section, and this is what you can see after the failure has happened. And other than when we investigated after during 2011 or so, it failed in August 2010 or so, we could see, other than the preliminary investigation at the feasibility stage, no detailed investigations of the dam foundation or the materials were carried out, and there was no documentations available. So adequate construction planning was not there. Hurried constructions were there, especially while closing the section. It was hurried. Adequate thought was not given to the planning and viability of the dam closure sequence. Dam closure section was completed within a period of 3 years instead of one season. Further, much steeper side slopes of the already constructed embankment sections adjacent to failed section was adopted, 1:4 normally adopted. The lift thickness adopted during the construction or the closest section was much thicker than the allowed one. No arrangements were made for the controlling of reservoir filling. So it failed during the first reservoir filling. So if you see the foundation, foundation in the breached portion, you can see the untreated cracks and joints. Many wide, deep and continuous joints were seen running from the upstream side to the downstream side, both the longitudinal and transverse, covering the whole area of the breached portion. No sealing of these joints and the cutoffs were not provided. We agree for a irrigation projects, cutoffs were not provided, but it was a 30 meter high medium irrigation projects, it should have been provided. So the depth of the water in the reservoir had risen from 0 feet to 46 feet over a period of just 20 days. The maximum rise in a day was of the order 11 feet. A day before the reported failure, the reservoir had recorded a rise of 6 feet. Even at the time of failure, the reservoir was on the rising strain. But unfortunately only, I have to see the people living in the downstream side of the dam have noticed muddy waters coming from the downstream slope of the dam, which was ignored. If you see this section, you can see the true sense of the homogeneous material. It's not having any filter at all. It is supposed to, if you remember the cross section which I showed, the filter material has to be there, but it's not there. No arrangements were made for the controlled reservoir filling. And if you see, the longitudinal cracks were there in the downstream portion of it. Gullies were, rain cuts were seen and gullies were seen. It was difficult to confirm by visual inspection of the breached section any chimney filter was provided or not. Chimney filter. So that is why extensive three-phase investigation, geotechnical investigations were done by CSMRS at different point of the time. And in CWC, in consultation with the CSMRS, provided at the end of the investigations, what we have to do, we say CWC and CSMRS said, abandon the structure and construct a structure in different dam alignment. But that was not affordable. So we have to give a modified section of the unbreached portion and the breached portion. So unbreached portion has to be the downstream. Entire downstream was moving and it was having a lot of distresses, and vertically that was cut and it was rebuilt. And since the cutoffs were not provided, the dam was from the upstream face was provided with the extra precautions and it was grouted. And the modified section for the breached portion also was provided by using the geosynthetics materials. This is the unbreached portion dam section. It was cut, trimmed off, and the breached portion will be constructed. And the unbreached portions are covered with the good material, soil material, and covered with the geotextiles, non-woven geotextile, to function as a filter, and then geomembrane, and then upstream phase was provided with the geomembrane for giving the water tightness. And then this is material is spreaded, and you can see it is compacted with a good compactor. And this is the trimmed downstream phase of the dam, you can see. And this is the grouting arrangements which was done on the upstream side of the embankment. This is downstream portion. This is what non-woven geotextile and the geomembrane. And this is the filter material which is being used for the construction of the dam. Coming to the conclusion part, the failure of the embankment dam results in a catastrophic incidence. Major causes of the embankment dams are the concentrated leaks and internal erosion. The structures are to be inspected frequently during the construction, post-construction, and during the operation to detect any abnormal behavior of the structure. Documentation of the structure is very, very important at all stages. In my experience, we are missing out this documentation during the constructions, at the pre-feasibility stage, what was it during the construction, and post-construction, what is the documentation available. We are very helpless in deciding about giving the solution to any kind of structure which is in distress. Type of distress in the structure to be recorded in detail. Proper planning and investigations are required to find solutions to the distress. Good quality control and quality assurance is mandatory during the construction stage to avoid the distress. Instrumentations are to be installed in the structure to monitor the behavior of the structure. With this, I am coming to the end of my lecture, and I thank IGS Guntur chapter and the college, and especially my thanks are to Professor Rao for giving me this opportunity to address all of you on embankment dams, distress and manifestation. Thank you so much. And this is a works of our big team of CSMRS. It is my personal experience only. It's the experience of my big team. Thank you so much.
Thank you, madam, for the excellent presentation. Before question answer session, I will share Google Form link, and its purpose is sharing the PDF content of the lecture and the feedback of the participants. Now I request the participants to copy link, Google Form link. And this is the Google Form link. I request you, all of you, copy the link. And its purpose is sharing the PDF content of the lecture and your feedback. Now I request participants to send their questions to chat. So I will make it as everyone. Just wait. Now I think all of you observe the Google Form link. So now I have sent to everyone. Now I request participants to send their questions through chat. Madam, kindly observe the chat.
Yeah, I'm already started looking at it. Am I audible now?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. The first question is, how good is fly ash mixed with clay as material for rehabilitation of earthen dam? Dr. S.K. Sharma has asked. So what I would like to say is, for retaining water retaining structures, better to avoid the fly ash material, because if you see the fly ash, it's a non-cohesive material totally. So if you mix with clay also, and specifically for rehabilitation of the earthen dam, even for construction of the earthen dam, we are not allowing so far. Even the updated version of the IS code, we have not incorporated into it, but provided in the non-critical sections, you can use the fly ash material for the construction of the embankment dam or anything. But in the critical sections, we cannot allow it. Though it is a frictional material having a good strength, but it is totally non-cohesive in nature. For the construction of the embankment dam, the first and prima facie criteria is permeability. Next is shrinkage limit. Another is the plasticity index. The plasticity index of the fly ash is generally non-cohesive only, mostly non-cohesive. And the plasticity index, of course, non-cohesive, shrinkage limit is very high. That also we cannot allow. And the permeability, yeah, of course, it is semi-pervious or pervious drainage characteristics it has. So we don't use it, sir. Thank you. Second one, for the Garada case study, Ms. Dolaroy Chowdhury has asked, we see textile below the liner on upstream side. Yes, ma'am. actually, to cut short, it was very difficult for me to complete it in 1 hour. So I had to take, I think, 1.5 hours for presenting my study topic. What I missed was what all the investigations we did it. When we have to do the permeability, state of the existing unbreached portion, the permeability was very poor. Total water loss were there when we were tested with the permeability test. So we have to provide the water tightness to the structure. Since you know how the structures are planned, so I can't say it in a public forum like this. So to rescue those things, we have to adopt these kind of design. It is exclusively for this project only. Maybe a first one as far as the embankment dam is concerned. So if you have any detail you want to know it, you can come to our office at any time. I'll explain you in personally. Sorry. Okay. Thank you. And next is from Kiran Kumar. What is the tentative depth of investigation of earthfill with reference to height dam in case of non-presence of rock strata? So this again, it is a big topic actually. People always come to us how much we have to investigate overburden. Actually, while we are selecting the construction of the earthen dam because foundation strata is very weak, but we can strengthen it. What we have to have is piping through foundation we have to avoid. So with the design parameters, we can do it. Depth with reference to the height, specific codes are there. You can refer to it. And then we can go for at least the equivalent to the height of the dam you have to investigate with. And rock strata, it's not required. You have to go up to the rock strata, but there are design means available how you have to design it. So that are available. If you want to know that in details, you can just write to me. My email ID, I think everybody can note down. chitra009@gmail.com. If you write to me, I can send you those details. And the second question from Mr. Kiran Kumar is specifications of clay material in case of zoned composite dam. Since clay exhibits swelling characteristics, usage of fly ash material, I have already explained you usage of fly ash material. We cannot allow usage of fly ash material for the critical sections. And the specification of the clay core material, like I said, sir, the first criteria is shrinkage limit. Shrinkage limit, if it is lower the shrinkage limit, higher the swelling characteristics. So the shrinkage limit is limited to 12 and should not be more than 25 also. So that is the first characteristic. And the permeability criteria, it should be 10 to the power of minus 7 centimeter per second in case of a normal soil. And if it is a dispersal soil, then it is to be limited to 10 to the power of minus 9. The permeability water tightness should be more so that even the smallest particle present in the embankment material is not going away with the flow of the water. But in the case of swelling material, soil, the criteria differs. The higher the swelling potential, the density you have to choose should be loose so that it has the pores for the volume expansion. And the higher the dense of the soil, more will be the swelling potential. So you have to be very careful. And the moisture variations, you have to better avoid it. So then with that, the design criteria, if you fix it, then you will be able to manage it. And if you see, that is what is the optimum moisture content you will have to adopt for the construction of the embankment dam. There are many school of thoughts, which one you have to do for homogeneous dam. And at the clay, center of the clay core or at the contacts of the clay core and with other zones. that you have to be very careful. And next, could we provide NWGT or composite drain with the stones on downstream side? Yeah, ma'am, you are, this is again by Ms. Dolarai Chowdhury. You have to tell me which one I have to use. I think if I talk in detail about what is to be mentioned, okay, we will think of this and then I'll just send you my answer to it. For the Garada yesterday, she's not leaving. We see geotextile below liner upstream side. I think I have answered this. And what is the remedy if a highly expansive is available locally for embankment constructions? I think 25% of what we have to do, I have just mentioned it. There are, we have to take care while designing those kinds of things. That is why we call it as a hearting zone and the casing zone. The moisture variation in the expansive soil, we cannot afford to have it. We have to give a control, get a control over it. We have to design it accordingly. Can you briefly talk about the Teton Dam failure, USA 1976? Mr. Mohan Ramanathan is asking, during the first trip, what were the precautions to be taken in the design? Actually, Teton Dam, it is a very interesting story. You can study about this in the internet. Many people are, even post-failure analysis, people are doing it. Problem was, the first leakage was found out in the contacts of the structure and the abutment. And this failed during the first reservoir filling and with the uncontrolled rate of reservoir filling, because it was raining on the 4th of June 1976 or 74, I think. And within 4 hours of after seeing the leakages, it just, the gushing of water came out and it failed it, and 11 people died out of it. The main reason was the filters provided in the cutoff foundation was single filter only. And the problem was many fold actually. Inadequate investigations we can see. The abutment was, the geotechnical investigation of the abutment was not properly studied, and the water traveled from the reservoir through the abutment to the downstream portion at the contact of the embankment dam to the abutment. So that is what the reason. And it's a classic case. Everything, whatever I have included in my conclusion, monitoring was not proper. And after seeing the small leakages also, only one person was there, and he notified the appropriate authority, but care was not given and it just gushed. Even today, the spillway, which is standing without any support, you can see in the Google map. And what are the precautions to be taken in the design of embankment dams for earthquake zones? Earthquake zones, like I said in the beginning of the my lecture itself, you have to go for, it's better to go for rockfill dam than the embankment dam. Embankment dams are not good for the highly seismic prone area. The precautions, material, proper material you have to select, and the material which is susceptible to liquefaction you have to avoid, like that many things are there. And what are the this is from Dr. Khanna, what are the immediate safe remedial measures for embankment dam in stresses? Dr. Khanna, that depends on the what kind of distress. Like I said, it may be a transverse cracking, it may be a longitudinal cracking. Generally, we say longitudinal cracks are not dangerous at all. But sometimes, why? The reason, if you find out, then it is dangerous. If it is a very wrong, very, the depth of the crack, and those things are very important. And immediately you have to provide it. You cannot wait for more time, because this distress, it could be aggravating. Once the water is going inside those kind of cracking, it will lead to a disaster. And especially the transverse cracking, that is because of what? Tension in the structure, and maybe because of the the distress in the crest, low lying in the area in the stress, maybe some portion of the material inside the structure is loose. So that is why you are exposed. So distress should be immediate. You cannot wait for more time. If you are having a fever, you may try to slow down your fever or get rid of that fever with the tablet. But at this point of time, you have to look into each symptom very carefully. So distress in dam, you cannot afford to it. So you have to rectify it immediately. Yeah, I think we are ending with the, yeah. Any other questions?
No. Further questions, they may send to your mail, madam.
One more question.
Okay.
This is Mr. Ravindra Vasa. What are the measures to stop the leakage of water in construction of the dam? No, I don't understand this question. During the construction of the embankment, there is no leakage of water. Leakage is movement of the slopes. I can consider at the toe of the movement, some kind of embankment or with the sandbags, you can try to arrest the movement of the slope, slope which is sliding, like what it is done in Kasingdan Dam. It was the foundation itself, it was very weak. So they expected the failure of some kind of movement of the structure may happen. So Kasington Dam was a very lengthy dam, and it was highly instrumented dam with a lot of drainages and all. So when they see through these instrumentations, the upstream slope of the dam is moving immediately after the end of the construction, then they have stopped the movement of that upstream slope by providing a berm at the upstream slope toe, at the end toe of that slope. So by that they could able to arrest the movement of the dam, and the dam was rescued and it was filled. And even today, it is functioning very well, and it is a tourist spot. You can read about these things in the internet as well. But if you have the instrumentation, that is the last point of my conclusion. With the observation and the instrumentation and the monitoring properly, you will be able to avoid any kind of disaster which is happening. Have you, one gentleman is asking, have you worked on any tailing dams? Can you please give those cases in India and the difference of tailing dams with the embankment dam? CCSMRS has worked with the tailing dams also. The oldest case which I can remember is Kudremukh Dam, and we have been, the basic problem is tailing dam is not used for the water. It's not a water retaining structure. And embankment dam for water retaining structures is different than the tailing dams. I think we are coming to the end of very enriching questions. I think no more questions, I think.
Okay, madam. So thank you for the excellent lecture and a lively question session at the end.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you to Dr. R. Chitra madam and the participants. So thank you, madam.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.